we'll get going here. I just want to start in, and it's Mark's project, not mine, now. No, but we started this back in Don's here, and he was here when we tried to get this going in 2006. We started trying to get this, pushing this, trying to get this through council. It's taken us till now. It's how long it took us to even get the money to do this project. Council's behind this, and what we're looking at, this is the beginning, like it says, 101. We're just starting this thing. We want to get it going. This is something that'll be a tool from as years go on. I mean, this is an asset management tool. It's going to require everybody to put in some work into this, and that's what I think Scott's going to explain, that they're going to try and build this thing from what we do in the way of maintenance, rather than have a program and then try and fit what we do into their program. It's the other way around on this one. So I want everybody to hopefully get behind it. If not, you're going to be doing it anyways, and I'll make sure you're assigned it. So hopefully we can all enjoy it while we do it. So I'll turn it over to Mark now, and we'll pass the sign-in sheet around just so they know who is here.
I'll caveat that if I say anything that doesn't sound coherent, I'm not running on much sleep right now, so I'll try to be coherent. As Rob said, I mean, this is kind of an asset management 101, just kind of start learning what this process is about. The CIP prioritization project we're going to be taking is just kind of a small step in that direction. But I want to think, you know, everybody here is really good at maintaining our infrastructure. We know how to maintain it. We are really diligent about it. What this is going to be is a tool to help us manage smarter and do it in a more efficient way and identify those things more clearly, what actually needs to be maintained, what needs to be rehabbed, what needs to be reconstructed. And that's kind of a, you know, real broad brush, really simple, but there is a lot of work, a lot of change that needs to be involved in that, and this will be your introduction. We've got Scott Bash from HDR, who is our consultant here, who's going to be doing the presentation today. He'll also be leading us through the workshops, and if you all didn't get an invitation for the Wednesday and Thursday workshops, you should have. If you're invited to this meeting, I invited you to that one too, so you should all have that. And those are four more separate workshops on Wednesday morning, Wednesday afternoon, Thursday morning, Thursday afternoon. Those will all be up at Corporate Yards when we do that. The Council Chambers was not available for those dates, so we'll be doing all those up at Corporate Yards. So with that, I'd like to turn it over to Scott and start our class. Thanks.
Hey, thanks for coming.
So what we're going to talk about today is Asset Management 101. As a consultant, I have, I guess, a lot of theories about how it works, and then a lot of experience with practical applications. I'll start by saying this. You guys already do asset management. You've got assets and you manage them. What we're going to talk about today is ways that you programmatically organize all this stuff so that there's some consistency between different parts of the organization, different groups, whether you're doing a work order on a water asset or work order on a facility or work order on a park bench or whatever it might be. So that when you roll all the information together, you can bring it up to the top to say, what impact does this have on the community? What impact does it have on the rates that the customers, whatever it might be? And how do we make our jobs more efficient? And so there's a little bit of introduction here in that the way I think through asset management is that the community owns the assets and you're stewards of that. So the decisions that you make with a catch basin or with the parks or with any one of the buildings is that you're basically spending the community's money. And in most cases, you know more about how that money is being spent than the community does. As a citizen, I think the average citizen really does not know what happens underneath the ground. If you're going into a sewer, for example, you probably know what the sewer does, and if you were to talk to somebody like maybe a long-lost cousin and say, what are you doing now? And you start to explain to them about, you know, your activities, they'll like, their whole mind will be freaked out. They have no idea what happens when we're interfacing with sewer infrastructure or water infrastructure. They know about streets, they know about parks, they know about the above-ground stuff, they see it, they touch it. The underground assets are a little bit more fuzzy for them. And so you know what to do. The question is how do you convey that to the citizen, to the ratepayer, when you have to go ask them for more money because our infrastructure is falling apart or starting to degrade? And so you've got to be able to have this dialogue. And so what we're doing is we're looking at ways at which we can use the community's money as effectively as possible. The other thing that asset management brings to us is really you know, kind of a problem-solving approach, so that we all know how to get down into the root issue instead of just dealing with the symptoms. And the reason why we want to do that is that if we're just dealing with symptoms of problems, then what usually happens is the political body comes in and starts laying out more laws. Or one of these guys here lays out another policy. Because what they're trying to do is they're trying to remove the symptom. But if we can get down into the root issue of the problem and remove the root issue of the problem, the symptom goes away. We don't have as many policies. We don't have as many rules. We don't have as many laws that constrain us in our daily activities. So in asset management, we want to think about that. We want to think about the problem-solving process. And the third, and probably the most important thing in what we do in programmatic asset management is how we take this information that we all generate, all this data that we're creating, all these forms and maps and files and drawings that we're constantly collecting and storing someplace. How do we turn that stuff into knowledge, and how do we share it amongst ourselves so that we're not digging up information or having to go back and redo something all the time? So we're going to kind of walk through these things. So asset management is a programmatic approach. It's a structured program of how we minimize the cost of asset ownership. And really, more importantly, is how do we deliver service as effectively and as reliably as we can, and how do we sustain that over the life of all the assets that we've got? When were most of the sewers and water systems built here? Was it in the 40s, 50s, 60s? Okay. So they're probably getting close to the end of their useful economic life. You probably still got a ways to go before it really becomes a major issue. And so as far as the timing goes of forecasting and thinking about the end of useful life of these things, you're at a ripe point where you're going to start to really reap the benefits of some of these concepts. Because what we're trying to do is we see that, you know, the assets are degrading over time, and then your investments are going to start to go up. And we have to look at, you know, how much money we've got and how do we use that money as effectively as possible. You want to replace the asset just before it fails. Right, or you want to be able to think about how to replace it as soon as it fails and reduce your reaction time. Now, every utility, every public works organization, every one of your peers out there is dealing with very, very similar problems to you, but every scenario is unique. You have a unique set of people that sit at the city council that are making the decisions or approving decisions that you're making. You have a unique environment, cultural environment, as well as weather environment. There are unique economic situations. There's unique businesses that are here. There's unique people. I mean, people live here, and some of you guys live here, and there's a reason why you live here. Either you're born here or you migrated here for some reason, whatever. The fact of the matter is that every organization is unique. And so what we have to think through is what makes us different, what makes us important. What are the issues that we're dealing with, whether it's aging infrastructure or some type of, you know, catastrophic failures that are about to happen. We've got to try to identify what those drivers are. And we then have to look at what's the impact of that on our assets. So what this diagram here is the typical life of an asset. And what we've got is we've got the acquisition stage. Now, this is maybe that you build the asset, you've acquired it that way, or it may be that a developer built it and you all of a sudden have to take over on it. Whether you pay for it or the builder pays for it, it's still the community's money in one way or another, and you still have a large capital outlay, which is the beginning of the life of the asset. Then at some point it goes into the O&M mode, operations and maintenance mode, and there's a cost associated with that. And then at some point, with a lot of assets, there is going to be a periodic outlay of capital in the nature of a rehabilitation cost, a refurbishment cost, maybe a big repair. Sometimes those are O&M dollars, and sometimes they're big dollars, and so we capitalize them. And then eventually the asset retires. And there is a cost to disposing of an asset. If you had like a pump station and it's kind of reached the end of its useful life and you're replacing it, then you put a new pump station in there, for example, there's the cost of disposing of the old one before you put the new one in. In most cases, they kind of wrap all that into one big cost of the project, but in reality, it's two different lives that are taking place. So this is what we refer to as the asset life cycle. And there's a reason why they call it a cycle. because it acquire, operate, maintain, rehab, retire. It kind of keeps going like that. And so what we want to do is we want to think through the different parts of this. So the first one is an acquisition process. And we think about, how do we acquire assets? Do we have a plan for doing this? If we acquire these assets, we've got these drawings, these as-builts, these engineering specs, and all this sort of stuff. We've got maybe some GIS data. We've got maybe some maintenance records, some O&M manuals, all this kind of stuff. And we're collecting all this information. How do we deal with that stuff? And what do we do with it when we get it? Do we just file it someplace, or do we put it into our maintenance management system? Do we store it in a SCADA system, or do we throw it onto a shared drive or something like that? Then we need to have a way at which we think about how we're going to operate the asset over time. Some assets, like, we don't really operate a park bench, but we do in a sense, because we're kind of walking around inspecting it from time to time. We've got a maintenance strategy of how we maintain things. How often do we paint the building, how often do we replace the roofing, how often do we clean the sewers, those sort of things. Then we have a rehabilitation plan. Now, a lot with the mechanical stuff, if you put in a pump, for example, then maybe every 8 years, you're going to be doing some refurbishment or update on this pump. And so that's going to be outlay of cash. If we know it's going to happen every 8 years and it's going to cost whatever it is, $7,000, $10,000 to do that, let's go ahead and put that as a placeholder in our budget. And think about that, make sure that we've got money for the eventuality of doing an upgrade on that. So that's the rehabilitation plan. And then finally, like I talked about before, you got to think about what's going to happen when this thing retires. You know, how do you get rid of it? How many people here own a car? That's good, just about everybody. Do you think about the retirement of that car? Have you already thought about what the next car is you're going to be buying? Have you thought about the what you're going to get as a resale value for the car you're driving right now? At what point do you run this thing to the ground, or do you do like my dad always did, is he bought a new car every 2 years. So he bought a new car, drive it off the lot, drive it for 2 years, and then go out and buy another new car. I've bought one new car in my life. I'll never buy another new car again. I always buy a used car. It's you lose like 30% of the value when you drive off the lot, I think is what they say, right? And, you know, you're dealing with all these getting to know the car, breaking it in sort of stuff. And then I just drive that thing till it really doesn't function much anymore. I drive it to the ground. That's the way I do it. But other people can look at different strategies of that. So you got to think of the retirement plan. So what I'm going to do now is talk about this from a standpoint of a framework of asset management. And I can tell you this from a consulting world, is that there are lots of different asset management frameworks. Every vendor that sells asset management software, every consultant who preaches asset management has their own wheel or charts or flow charts of some sort or whatever. This is just another one. It's not to say that this is the best. It's just a framework. And I'm going to use this framework to explain, at least in my terms, what asset management means. And then you guys got to think through whether or not this makes sense, or do we modify it to meet, again, your unique situation. So we've got this asset lifecycle thing I talked about before. And the first thing to look at, from my viewpoint, is the service levels. So the service levels are the services that you provide to the customers. And to what level do you provide those services? All right, there is a certain level of expectation that they have in what you do. And if you don't meet those expectations, there's risk for doing so. So we balance out the levels of service with the risk of not meeting those levels of service. And how do we mitigate that risk? And then we build in this thing called a strategy. Personally, I've worked with asset management systems since 1992. And I think that in the United States in particular, asset management just becomes this term that becomes very difficult to explain to people. My personal opinion is that we shouldn't call it asset management. We should just call it utility business management. And that all the stuff we talk about with asset management should be incorporated into the utility business plan. So there isn't necessarily an asset management leader. It's everybody's managing assets. There isn't necessarily an asset management plan, it's a strategic plan. There's not necessarily an asset management information system, it's a whole bunch of information systems. Because you could argue that GIS is an asset management system. You could argue that Cartograph is an asset management system. You could argue that the financial fixed account system is an asset register. Well, they all are. So they're all information systems we've got to figure out how to do. So it should be incorporated as part of the enterprise strategy. But the one big thing that becomes different in what we do with a programmatic asset management concept is the way at which we make decisions about assets. And the key thing in terms of making decisions is that it feeds into that asset lifecycle at any one of these stages. How do we make decisions on how to operate, maintain, refurbish, and the like? And so to do that, we've got all people, like the people that are in this room, the people that aren't in this room, that are out there doing work right now, and the way at which they work together within processes and consistently within processes and always thinking forward. And then the final piece here is how do we use information about those assets, combine that with the experience that we've got. And when you take information and mix it with experience, that's what we got is knowledge. So how do we use that asset knowledge as effectively as possible? So this is a framework of asset management that covers all the pieces. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to drill down into each one of these individually. If you've got questions, raise your hand or just blurt out the question that you've got. Or if you have something you want to, you know, stimulate the audience with a great story, that's good too. I've got enough slides here to talk for 4 hours. And I'm going to do it in less than two. And if we get into discussions and stuff, I'm going to cut through a couple of the slides and skip ahead. So we've got the ability to do that as well. Okay, so everybody comfortable with talking? They've already come to get us. So let's talk about the service levels. So this is a kind of a bizarre concept. The idea of someone provides a service, i.e. you, but which happens first? Do you provide the service or the customer requests the service of you? It's not really a chicken and egg in this case. There's a reason why there's a sewer system and there's a parks department. It's because somebody wanted these things. The community wanted them. And we thought about this from a public health issue a long time ago and said, it's probably better than everybody defecating on the streets to put it into some big pipe and push it someplace else. And so we invented this thing called a sewer system. And somebody else had the brainy idea of putting water in pipes and bringing it to your dwelling instead of having to walk 8 miles to go get it. And we got a water distribution system. And somebody else said, we need to have a place where we can all gather, we call these parks, and we need to have a way to get there, we call these streets, and we need to have traffic control, and we have these things called signs and switches and stuff like that, and the story goes on and on. And so the community sort of requests these services, and we provide this stuff. And the key thing is, how do we provide this service? That it's that middle interconnection right there, that it's to the level of service we're going to be providing this, because we could be the most stellar utility on the planet, but the problem is the customers are not going to want to pay for that. So you provide this service, and then you say, well, this is the amount of money that we need from you to provide this service, and then they're weighing it out in their minds respectively, and not everybody weighs it out exactly the same way. Some people, I've seen them because I've been to some of your city council meetings before, some people want really, really a lot of service, and other people don't want any service because of they look at the cost. So you can't conceivably balance this thing out across everybody, so it's an average, if you will. And the whole idea here, which is interesting, is that when I first started getting involved in asset management, I was working for Sydney Water Board in Australia. And the concept of service levels came to bear, and here's the way it works with a utility in Australia. In particular, I'll give you an example of Hunter Water, which is a big water authority there. If you are without water for 2 hours, in a given day, more than 2 hours, you don't have to pay for water that month. So that's the service level agreement. So the people on the other side who are saying that there's a pipe break and they got to scramble, they know that if they don't get this thing fixed in 2 hours, they're going to lose revenue. So think of the way it raises the priority bar. If you've got, say, 10,000 customers without water and they're not going to be paying their water bill that month. So what it does is it trickles down into the organization to help drive priorities. Now, I'm not suggesting that's going to happen here, and I've tried working through this concept. Matter of fact, Seattle Public Utilities is dealing with this issue right now, whether or not they're going to do this. King County went through this a little while ago. Cincinnati MSD has gone through this. A lot of people are wrestling with this concept, but I just kind of wanted to lay it out there. So it works like this. We levels of service. The first thing we do is to say, what services do we provide, and who are the customers who use this service? Then we say, what are the expectations that they have from this service that we provide? And we try to then, us being the supplier, align ourselves with the customer. And what that does is it defines the level of service, right? So services you provide, who gets them, and to what level do you provide those? Then you come down and you say, all right, so if that's the service level, that's the target we're trying to reach, then what are the things that we have to do to reach that target? These are the activities we perform. And then we ask ourselves, what's the information we need to run the business to be able to manage those activities? And then what metrics do we need to measure this to a certain performance level? And then that drives the key performance indicators. So oftentimes what I get asked is, what should I be measuring? What sort of reports do I need? What sort of information system do I have to have? You can't answer that question until you go through this process. What are you in business for? Who do you provide services to? What do they expect? And then you go down into the processes. How do you guys generate work orders? How do you get a new water service turned on? How do you maintain the facilities you've got? What's the frequency of doing this? Who maintains your vehicles? All this sort of stuff. Then once you do that, you say, well, what's working, what's not working? What do you need to do to improve performance? And then that's what you measure. But here's what I find probably 9 times out of 10, is you go into an organization and they've got these maintenance management systems and financial systems and timekeeping systems or whatever. There's always forms to fill out. And people are filling out these forms and religiously storing them or whatever, and they go into a system and nobody ever goes in and gets the information. Or somebody goes in to try to get the information is not there because nobody put it in. So what we tend to do when we look at information systems is we install it, we buy it, we install it, we train people on it for a week or so. Vendor's gone, now we own it, and we're using it. And there's these blank fields, and so we start filling them out. And in some cases you use the data, in a lot of cases you don't. And there's a lot of waste that happens in data collection. On the other side is there's data that you really need that you never knew that you needed because you never knew the question was going to come up, and the system doesn't allow you to put that data in. And so when you do want to go run the report and you go in, well, it's not there. I can't run the report. A and B, there's even if I did run the report, we don't collect that data. We don't have the serial number of the meter or whatever it might be. It's not something we normally collect. So the point here is that everything that you do in terms of activities needs to be associated with what service you provide and the expectations of the service you provide. That's really kind of asset management 101 right there. Always tie your activity to the service level. Don't do any more, don't do any less. Do just the right thing. And so that means that you have to communicate with the stakeholders. You have to get them involved in defining what you do. And there are stakeholders all over the place. We normally go to the ratepayer, and we think through that. We oftentimes react to the political community. There's always these activists that are really kind of in your face sort of thing. They're at the public meetings. They're the ones that always have the question. No matter what happens, they always have a question or a statement they need to make. And we often react to them. But we need to listen to them because they are representing people that have the same issues. That's what they are, activists in the community. And so they've got a good story to tell, and they do represent a lot of people. So they're not worth ignoring. It's really worth listening to. The media, the banks, all these people are stakeholders of what you do. And I'm kind of surprised in what we do in a public utility setting is that we don't interface with our community very often. We will have public meetings and we'll hear the people, but we don't normally go out and ask people on the street, are we doing a good job with the service we're providing? Is there anything that we could be doing better? Sometimes we send out mailers as part of a bill stuffer. Sometimes we put it on our website. Sometimes we have open meetings and stuff like that. But the people that come are the people that already know what's going on. It's the people that don't come is what we need to be touching. And because when it comes down to we need to raise rates and we need to get this approved, you're asking for them to vote on it. And if they don't know anything about it, they're going to only vote on their perception of reality. So you educate them. And the way I always think through this is a smart constituent makes a smart decision. An educated consumer makes an educated decision. And so what we need to do is think through how to educate them, and the best way to do that is to get them involved in any way that you can. Lots of ways to do that. So the strategic planning part of it. Now, if we were to have this stellar organization and these high levels of service, then what's going to happen is that we're going to have a lot of costs. It's going to cost a lot. And as we increase the levels of service, the amount of planned work is going to cost us more money. If we have low levels of service, then we're going to be in a reactionary mode, and we're going to have a lot of unplanned work that's going to cost us a lot of money. And so the point that we're trying to find is we're trying to find that break even and say, what's the level of service? That's where this balance between the level of service and how much it costs comes. And so that's what we're trying to do, is we're trying to target the lowest cost to provide the highest level of service possible for the money that we've got or people are willing to afford. Now, in a retirement community, usually the customers are willing to pay less, and so you got to lower the service to that. In an affluent community, usually willing to pay a little bit more, and so you have the ability to raise the levels of service. So you really want to kind of ask the constituents of where they want to be in that range. And then work towards that. You'll often find that the customer is willing to pay more than they're paying right now. They can compare this to their cell phone bill, they can compare this to their cable bill, they can compare this to their electric bill, and you'll find that water is one of the cheapest bills they pay. They expect it to be free. What's happening across the world, especially with privatization of water resources and water supply systems, is that the price of water is going up. Globally speaking. But in the United States, we still undervalue the water that we've got. Now with parks and these sort of things, I think people don't really, and streets for that matter, they really don't know what the cost of a square foot of pavement is, or a bridge or something like that. It's a little bit more difficult because they don't necessarily get a bill for that unless they're paying a toll. So we introduced this concept of what's called the adaptive organization. So if you are looking at this and you're looking at the cost, things change over time. The adaptive organization concept works like this. If we develop as an organization here a strategic plan, then we have a particular desired output that we're trying to achieve with that plan. And we have business drivers that become the inputs of this, the social, economic, environmental things that happen. The output is the levels of service that we provide. So if all things being equal, meaning that the business environment, the drivers never change, so we just manage our strategy and we achieve our results. But as everybody knows, the economy goes in cycles. Political whims are up and down. Politicians change. Political leaders have different agendas for different reasons based on what their constituents are looking for. And certainly with both the economic and the social issues, then there's the environmental issues. Regulations change on a regular basis. So the adaptive organization has to have the ability to assess what happens outside the organization and see what changes need to make. So after we do that, then we assess what's going on, and then we define what those changes are that we need to actually implement, and then we develop that process or the solution or whatever it might be, and then we implement it. And then once we implement it, we got to figure out how to sustain it. And this is where information systems come along to support us. And what we get are these things called key performance indicators. So the idea here is that in order for us to sustain all of this and fit back into our strategy, we have to understand the difference between what's a level of service or business result and then what's a performance indicator. Because the performance indicators are things that right now we can address those. There's the idea of if you're managing your business based on financial results and financial results alone, by the time you get the financial results, it's too late to do anything about it. In most cases, already, in some cases, 6 weeks old. But if we can figure out what do we manage as the input to this along the lines of maybe I'm generating a work order and my manager is looking at the amount of X stuff that I do in a given day, and if I meet X, then I come in at the end of the day and he or she is happy. If I don't meet X, then they say something to me about, like, what were you doing? Where did you go? Why did it take you so long? That's more of a lagging indicator. There's nothing you can do once the work day's already over, you've got to figure out while you're doing the process of how I manage that performance or that productivity. And the same thing in a business standpoint, you can't manage just the output, you've got to figure out what am I trying to change. And I say that to say this, the meat of it is that when it comes to stuff like what do you measure, the only thing you should really be measuring are the things that you're trying to change. Right, so if for example, my objective is to become healthier and I want to lose 20 pounds, I want to be able to run a marathon by the end of the year, and I don't run now, then what I've got to do is I got to look at my exercise program, I got to look at my sleeping program, I got to look at how much I eat and what I eat, and I got to think about, okay, if I'm going to run 26 miles and I don't run anything now, I got to take baby steps unless I got to walk and run for a little bit. So I can measure those things. I'm not measuring my marathon time at this stage because that's a lagging indicator. But I can measure my weight every day. I can measure what I eat. I can measure how much I sleep. I can measure the amount of physical exercise I get, and I can stage this and plan this over time. And then I can accomplish my goal, which is to run a marathon in, say, less than 5 hours or 4 hours or whatever it is. So it's the same with performance indicators. You measure what you want to change. You measure what you want to manage to perform, and then the result will come. And it's the same with anything that we do. The key part about this is how do we assess changes? Then how as a group, how do we define, develop, and implement those changes? And then what do we need to measure in order to be able to sustain it? Because if I were to come in and say, let's change your procurement process, there's a lot of rules that you've got already that are sacred cows that aren't going to be changed. But there is some things that we could change to streamline the process a little bit. So let's measure those things. Let's take the constraints, elevate them, and let's start to deal with the standards and things that we do have control over. Let's try to streamline those things. And let's measure whether or not it's making any impact or not. And then we start to work on the other constraints, those sacred cows, the policies that people have. And so what we're doing is we're assessing what we're trying to do. We're defining, developing, and implementing our changes. And then we're seeing whether or not those changes work. And if we continuously do this over time, we can sustain this. And eventually, we can change the procurement process. So when we go about developing this plan of this define, develop, and implement, the first thing we want to do is we want to look at where are we at right now? How do we manage these assets? And then the next part we go is where do we want to be? And the difference between these two things is a gap. And we ask this over, you know, what's where we want to try to do in the next year, where we want to try to do 3 years from now, what do we want to do ultimately, maybe 7, 8, 10 years. And then what comes out of the gap is these closures, these activities we have to do to effectively close the gap, and then that becomes our asset management plan. And then we start saying, well, what resources do we have available, and can we afford this stuff? And so we've got all these gaps, and maybe, I don't know, maybe there's 100. There's no way we're going to get all these things done, so we had to put some priority next to them. Maybe we only get 10 done now, and maybe we get another 10 next year, and maybe we just wait, and then let's reassess it 2 years from now, and then maybe reprioritize. So you sort of chip away at it one step at a time. And so what you do is you get this thing, which we think of it through kind of like a an evaluation gap analysis. And the blue on the bottom is where you're at, and the magenta is where you want to be. And it kind of visually shows across the board of what are the gaps that you're trying to close. And then you write objectives to close each one of those gaps. Because what's happening in an organizational level is that we're kind of maturing over time, just like, you know, like when we're babies, and then we go through this, you know, child stage, we go through this adolescent stage, become young adults, and then become older adults, and then eventually we get to the point where we kind of go back in child in mind, and then we retire, if you will. Organizations are a lot like organisms. They've got tangibles and intangible things. We don't run an organization like a machine because we've got people. And we, as an organization, do have a level of maturity. And this is something that comes out of what's called the Carnegie Mellon. We've got the level one through level five. Now, level one is that if I come in and say, what's your condition assessment program, whatever group that you're in, and you look at me like, what do you mean, condition assessment program? Well, that clearly shows me that you're at level one. You have no defined process and don't even know what I'm talking about. If you answer the question by saying, well, Charlie does all of that. And says, well, where's Charlie? Says, well, he's not here today. He's on vacation, but he's the one that takes care of all of our condition assessments. So what you've got is you've got an initial stage here. You don't really have any defined processes because Charlie has it in his head. And then you go, well, Charlie wrote this program and we've got it all written up, and I do some of this stuff too. Well, you've got a defined approach. It's written down someplace. And then level four is that not only do we have a defined approach, we have a way to measure whether that condition assessment program is working. And then level five is we have this all across the entire enterprise. We do condition assessment as part of our normal checklist. We have information stored in a condition assessment database. It's tied to our maintenance management system. We have key performance indicators that we track for condition assessment. We use this to prioritize our CIP. And we're continuously learning ways to update the way we construct projects, the way we maintain and operate projects, and it's a perpetual process that we use on a continual improvement basis. So you're at level five. Most cases, most utilities are in level one or level two. We've got a lot of stuff documented. It's not continuously improving because we're always working shorthanded. We never have enough money. We never have enough people. And we kind of get stuck in that rut sometimes. It's very difficult to get up to level four or five. And in most cases, you don't even need to. Some things you might, but not everything. So when we look at these gaps and we look at where we're at in our maturity level, we come up with these ideas that we turn into goals and strategies. And in an organization like this, where there's people representing a lot of different parts of public works, there's going to be a lot of commonality between things we want to do, but there's also going to be some differences in terms of, you know, what one part of the system may do than another. So we want to have an asset management plan that fits into the strategic business plan that's universal from everybody, but yet can be specific for individual people. And so there, I'm going to introduce this concept here, which is called the balanced scorecard. Just a show of hands, anybody ever heard of this before? Good, one person. And the idea of a balanced scorecard is that you look at it from a number of different perspectives. You've got the customer perspective, you've got the financial perspective, you've got the business process, kind of in balance. So you ask your customer, what do you want us to do? And then you say, well, how much can you afford to do? And then you look at what are the processes that we need to perform. And then once you start figuring all this out, then you say, all right, if we're going to do all that, then how are we going to learn and grow over time after we got this established? So all four of these perspectives should be in balance. And the beauty about this is that the city, in particular public works, is complicated. The things you have to do are very complex. And your job at an individual level is extremely important, and you add a lot of value to the organization, but so does the person who works with you in your team, and so is he or she next to them. And then you take, I don't know how many hundreds of people there are in public works. How many people?
83.
And so you take all these people and then all the vendors and consultants and contractors and suppliers to you, you're getting into the hundreds. It becomes a very complex organization when you think through what are all the things that need to happen, and they have to happen in concert. So the idea of the balanced scorecard is that you start at the top and say, what are my goal that I'm trying to achieve? And maybe in this case, it's reliable service. You want the customer to be in alignment with that. You got to be able to sustain the service. And so that's what the customers expect. Then you say, okay, if that's what I'm going to provide, what do I have to do at the financial level? Well, I've got to be a viable organization from a financial fiduciary responsibility, and I got to be able to manage my costs. So these are my strategies at the financial level. And then internally, I've got to maintain the infrastructure that I've got, the asset management part. I've got a plan for the capital efficiently. I've got to manage the quality of the product that I'm delivering, and I've got to continuously optimize the organization. So these are the internal strategies.
And then to learn and grow over time, we need to keep this strategy, keep going, keep it active. We need to share information, share knowledge. We might as well learn the best practices that we can instead of reinventing the wheel. We got to recruit and we got to retain talent. And then we also need to enhance employee skills. So this is very basically of how you run a public works utility. Now, if you drill into any one of those things, you open up another can of worms, and there's a lot more detail behind it. But I can show you on one piece of paper, this is the strategies that you would typically do to manage a utility. And again, you drill down into the question is how low do you go? And I can measure the success of any one of these strategies. I can measure cost. I can measure optimization of an organization. I can measure skills. So then I can drive down into key performance indicators. So what it does when you're trying to set up a strategy is you're really trying to get into ways at which we can manage it, guide it, and more importantly, get people focused. So that's what a tool like the Balanced Scorecard does. So looking at this from a business approach, and this sort of concept here, is that we're looking at these strategies, and then we're saying, what are the processes that we need to do to meet the strategies? And then the real question is how do we motivate people to do it? All right, so like from a consulting standpoint, or even from a manager standpoint, I can come in and say, this is how you do it, and this is what you do, but it really comes down to getting you to want to do it before anything ever happens. So the human motivation part comes in. And my belief is that what we want to do is we want to recognize the value of every single person in the organization. And we want that person to recognize the value of the job that he or she performs. And if that person knows what they do, the purpose of their job, why they do what they do, how they interface with other people, they're more likely to be not only more productive, but more engaged in what they do and provide better quality. But there are a lot of people who come to work, you know, whatever it is, come in the morning, if they have a time card, I use that sort of mindset because it kind of goes back to my cartoon days, you know, where you got the punch card and you go to work, and then at the end of the day, you punch your card and you go home and do whatever you do. There's a lot of people that come in and do their work and then leave. There's a lot of other people that come in and do their work and then they can't leave the job. It goes home with them. You know, neither one of them is really the ideal situation. What you want to be able to do is you want people to come to work, fully engage in what they do, feel good about what they do, be productive, be happy, and then be able to come up with innovative ways at which they can improve the work and performance that they've got, and then share that with other people. And then as they leave the organization, they're translating what they learned to the next person who's coming up to take their place. And from a manager standpoint, where everybody knows their job and everybody feels good about what they're doing, that's a very harmonious situation to be managing. It doesn't necessarily happen that way in a lot of organizations. But that's sort of what we want to strive to do, I think, is feel good about what we do and have fun doing it and have a sense of belonging. So we get to the risk part. And this is very high level. This is kind of confusing, I think, for a lot of people in what we mean by risk. Because in most cases in public works, I guess it's fair to say that most of us are risk adverse. We don't take risk. We wear both belts and suspenders. We have tanks with other storage facilities. We have a pipe and we have another pipe. We build in a lot of redundancy. Part of what we're starting on right now is what's called a CIP, Capital Improvement Program. Prioritization process. And the question is if we have all these projects we have to do, which one to do first, which one's second most important, which one's third? And the real way to do that is to look at what's the value it provides and what's the risk if we don't do it. And so we introduce this concept of risk. And the way this works is that we have these consequences of failure and we have the frequency of failing. So as we go in this over here, we've got the consequence of failure, and over here is the frequency of failing or the probability. Okay, so these ones that are out up here, they got a high consequence of failing but not a high likelihood of failing. Those are the ones that get the attention of regulators. These are the bridge collapses. These are the big explosions of water lines. These are the sewers that had a problem in it, and a sinkhole is there. These are the ones where the stormwater pipe rushes out and blows out the road, and it's the only access or good access to the hospital. Those are the ones that get high consequences. So what we do with those in this area here is we really set up, we spend a lot of money doing condition assessment of those assets. Now, we've got other assets like light bulbs and drinking fountains and stuff like that. We just run those things to failure, and we replace them when they get there. And then we have some other assets that are, we use what's called a history-based economics. So how often do we change catch basin covers on stormwater drains? You know, we don't actively go out and replace these things. We say, well, it lasts about this long, and we're going to change them out, you know, every 75 years or whatever it might be, or maybe even with water meters. Sometimes that's the way we do those things. So these are things where you don't go out and measure the condition of a water meter. You change it when based on its historical performance. And so what we do is we have to define what's our acceptable level of risk. And then we take an asset and we put it on that risk profile. And we can take all of our assets and look at each individual asset and say, is it, you know, is it outside of our risk profile? Is it up here in the upper right-hand side? And if it is, it's outside of our acceptable level of risk, we gotta do something to reduce it. So we could do something to reduce its probability of failing. And we could do that by making a design change or maybe changing an operating procedure, or maintenance procedure. Or we could reduce its consequence. We could build some redundancy to it. Or we could do both. So all we're doing is saying, if it's outside, we got to think about it. So if it's outside of our acceptable level of risk, what do we have to do to get it inside our acceptable level of risk? And which one of these strategies is the best strategy? Do we set up a condition monitoring program? Do we just collect information about it and track it over time? Or do we just plan on running it to failure? Does that make sense? You guys intuitively do this, right? Do you write it down? Does it go into Cartograph or on a spreadsheet or anything with the sewer system? It does. And then you track it with condition ratings and stuff?
Not yet.
So this introduces something called the risk management framework. This comes out of an Australian New Zealand standard. You've probably heard of ISO. This is the Australian New Zealand equivalent of that. The way it works is that you establish the context of the risk that you've got. And you guys have, in the Parks and Recreation, you have swimming pools that you maintain? What's the biggest kind of asset that you maintain in parks? Okay, let's talk about a playground. There's a lot of risk in playgrounds that can affect people getting injured or whatever. So if we're looking at a jungle gym, for example, then we put that in the context of what we do as a business. And then we identify what those risks are associated with that. And we analyze the risk and evaluate them and say, what's the best way we can mitigate or treat the risk of someone getting injured at one of our park facilities? And then that becomes a strategy. You know, we might have change out the furniture, change out the equipment that's there. Or maybe we have somebody on site that's always going to be there. Or maybe we build some, you know, rubber pavement around the thing, or all these sorts of things we try to do. Is we can't eliminate the risk, but we can mitigate it. And then we monitor and review it over time, and then we also communicate and consult with ways that we can improve this as we go. So you can do this with any asset, sort of running it through the list. And what we're trying to do here is teach risk management and teach a process that we can track within our decision-making process. So whether it's our maintenance strategy, our operating strategy, or our CIP prioritization process, whatever it is, we just adopt a framework like this to be able to help us guide through this. It's, again, part of the concept, if you will, of asset management. Now, what a lot of times what people do is they take this number times this number and they give it like a 25, and you've got a 100 to a 0, and this project gets a 45. And there's another project here that gets a 67. And then we can rank them based on that. The problem with that is that, yeah, it is a number, but what's the difference between a 67 and a 66? We know that 67 is higher than 66. So if we decide that zero is low and 100 is high, then we know that 67 is higher than 45, and so it's got a higher priority. So with the concept of risk cost, what we do is we say that there's a probability of a risk event taking place. There's a probability of this bridge failing, or this road failing that's on the way to the hospital. And we take that probability in terms of, or a pipe, let's say a pipe water main break, right? So let's say a water main break once every 5 years. And every time it breaks, it costs $5,000. So what we've got is the frequency is 1 in 5 times $5,000 means that we have $1,000 per year of risk cost. Okay. So then the question becomes, how much does it cost to mitigate that risk? And if, let's say the example is, and these aren't real numbers, right? So I'm not very smart, so I have to put numbers that I can calculate. So let's say the mitigation cost is $750. So the question is, would you spend $750 to eliminate $1,000 of risk? Okay, I would too. What if it's $1,750 to mitigate the risk? Would you spend $1,750 to mitigate $1,000? And this is $1,750 per year to mitigate $1,000 worth of risk. Probably not. So this is the concept of why it's better to do it in dollars, because you have common denominator of dollars. Because if you've got an example of, you've got these different projects, and then one's got a 67 and one's got a 45, then okay, you know which one's higher priority. But when you start saying the project is going to cost money, how much money is it going to cost, and how much money are we going to receive in terms of a benefit? Then it becomes a whole different problem. So if you calculate the risk cost in terms of dollars, so now we get to the problem. You guys are in wastewater, right? What's the cost of an overflow? Exactly right. So you've got some, if you've got a sewer line that breaks, we've got the economic cost to replace it, excavate it, and repair it. We could probably figure that out historically. If the sewer overflows on the golf course that the mayor plays at, then it's got a different value, if you will, than it's a sewer at the end of a cul-de-sac and nobody lives in that cul-de-sac. We've got the environmental cost, a fine that we have to pay, as well as the reactionary time and all the monitoring stuff we have to do after that. If it's a sewer that overflows and you have to dig up the road and people can't get to those businesses, then those businesses that live along that strip mall or whatever, they're going to lose customers, they're going to lose revenue. So there's a social cost to that. It's very difficult sometimes to come up with that consequence of failure dollar amount. All we prescribe is that we just come up with a cost of an overflow, or come up with the cost of a catch basin collapse, or come up with the cost of a water main break, or come up with the cost of a park closing or something like that. And you say it's like $25,000. Well, what you do is that once you have an event that happens, measure the cost of it and track that over time. So let's start off with $25,000. That's the cost of an overflow. I don't know if it's high or low. That's just what we're starting with. And then over time, we find out that, no, it's actually $35,000. Then we just move that number up. And so you're iteratively learning over time as to what happens. But more importantly is that because you're measuring it, you're focused on it. And then you start to say, well, hold on a second. You know what we're missing here is when we do pay fines, but in reality, we're paying fines, but the money from the fines goes right back into the community again. So that's not really a cost, but we don't know if the money's used right. So we've got to kind of think through this stuff. And then it helps you to think more about what is the implications and the risk of an overflow, and what can we do to mitigate it. So it's one of those things, if you measure it, you manage it. And all this information can be stored in a database, whether it's a GIS system or a cartograph or a spreadsheet someplace, or 4x6 cards and a bulletin board and some thumbtacks. There's a lot of different ways you can manage this information. So we get now to the asset decision part. And so I talked before about the asset decision cycle. So there's these kind of five things that you do is acquisition plan, operating strategy, maintenance strategy, rehabilitation plans, or what we call asset plans, and then the asset retirement plans. Now, here's an example of something that'll probably blow your mind for a little bit. This is a reasonably new concept. And this first time I was introduced to this, I was doing a project for Orange County Water District. And they had built this, Orange County's on the coast of California, and they're drawing water out of the aquifer system. As they draw water out of the aquifer system, salt water's coming in and intruding into the underground aquifer. And so what they did is they built this wastewater treatment plant, basically. It was pushing water back and recharging the groundwater, trying to basically push the saltwater barrier out. And so it's this huge plant that they're building to inject basically raw wastewater back into the groundwater system. And so they came up with this idea is that as we're building these assets, let's start collecting all this information and start storing it in the place that it belongs. So the contract specifications included that they had to have these what you call smart P&IDs, which are drawings of where the pipes and instrumentation, all that goes, and all these data sheets and construction drawings and schedules and inventory. Now, this is an O&M manual. This is a maintenance management system. Cartograph is yours. This is a warehouse, like an inventory system. This is a SCADA system, process control system. This is a laboratory information management system. This is a document management system in GIS, and this is the finance system. So the way it worked is that in the construction documents that they were issuing out in terms of RFPs and the consultants and contractors were submitting this stuff, they had to use the asset nomenclature that the organization had set up. And so when the consultant was and the design engineer was doing their drawings, they actually put the asset number on the asset. And then they pre-populated the maintenance management system with that asset number and the nameplate data, the serial number of the asset, the manufacturer, the size, and all this sort of stuff. And then they went to the vendor, the manufacturer of the asset, like a pump or motor or switch gear, whatever it might be. They got the O&M manuals and they wrote out the job plans and pre-populated that stuff in the maintenance management system. They built in the SCADA system, the same asset numbering system and the same configuration. And they put all this information by asset into an asset register and had all this stuff pre-populated. So by the time that went through the commissioning process and the client for the organization, in this case, the Orange County Water District, they didn't have to do all this stuff. And so by the time the people took over on the asset and all the plant, everything's pre-populated. And so in most cases, what we do is that we get the drawings from the different consultants. They use whatever tools that they've got, and then we have to digitize it, bring it into GIS. We have to type it all into the maintenance management system. We have to write up our O&M processes, or we don't, and we eventually get around to it. So this is a process that a lot of organizations are using now, is they're really forcing the people who are constructing, design these things to pre-populate all the information systems. So on the operation strategies, the key thing we're trying to do is we're trying to reduce costs, improve performance, meet regulatory compliance, all these sorts of things. And the other part about it is it should be the people side of it and what we do in terms of succession planning, who's doing our job when we retire and who are we teaching and all these sorts of things. And then the key one here is reduction in staff turnover. How many people here are going to be retiring in the next 3 years? Okay, so there's a low percentage of what's in the industry. Right now, the going rate or the going knowledge is that in the next 5 years, about 40% of the workforce in the water, wastewater, public works arena is going to be retiring. And I don't know if you've had any open positions lately or tried to hire somebody, but there's a lot less people coming into public works than there was in the 70s and 80s when a lot of these guys that are here now are going to be retiring. And turnover happens a lot more rapidly than it used to in the 80s and 90s. And so the question is, on operating strategy, you got to kind of think through that. You don't think of it as asset management, but it is. And the other thing that we talked a little bit about was condition assessment. So with your operating strategy, it needs to include some way to manage the condition of an asset. So I'm going to introduce this idea of deterioration curves. So what this curve shows is that as you go out in time, the asset, in this case, take this as an example as a pump. And a pump is pumping at 1,150 gallons per minute. And as you go out over time, it starts to degrade over time. If you don't do anything about it, right, it just becomes less efficient, like we all do. And so there is some point in time when it gets down to about 1,100 that we start to reach what we call potential failure. It starts to really fail at a much more rapid rate. We want to know what time that's going to be. If we can forecast that, we can do something and act on that through our operating strategy or maybe through our maintenance strategy. So we want to be able to detect that level of deterioration. Now, there's another point in time where it actually starts to functionally fail. It doesn't do what it's supposed to do. And we want to know what that time is. And that little area between there, that curve, is called the PF curve, or the potential failure curve. Now, there's a lot of research that has been done on material failure, pipes, concrete, wood, these sorts of things, that you can already use that information to help forecast what the deterioration of a pipe might be, or a road or whatever. But what we want to know is that PF curve for a particular type or asset class. But the other thing we want to look at is what happens if we get to total all-out failure? And what's the amount of time to meet our service level that we need at a minimum to react to that problem of total failure? That becomes a critical part of our reactionary plan, our strategy. So that's what condition assessment does for us. Now, once we understand that, then we can create what's called a maintenance strategy. And the simplest part of a maintenance strategy is run it to failure and have a plan to what you do when it fails. The next part is the preventive maintenance plan. These are ones where we can sort of put it on a calendar. We're going to do this every X number of hours or X number of days or whatever. Or we're going to do it seasonally. Then the next one becomes the managed plan. Now, this is where you have a combination of all that stuff, but then you do something that's called predictive maintenance. It might be like if you're operating a car, it could be like oil analysis, or it could be thermography. It could be some type of vibration performance analysis, something like that. With more of the static type assets, you don't do this kind of stuff. with a sewer pipe or a water line, condition assessment can be pretty expensive. Where you run a camera through it. And then there's the condition-based approach, which is a little bit, you have to be more careful about how you use your condition-based dollars, condition assessment dollars, because it costs money to do condition assessment. But you can also do this leveraging some more real-time control systems. If you're managing assets that aren't here, you can set up a camera, set up a microphone, look at it remotely, tie it through the SCADA system, have an event that triggers a work order, or trigger some type of a fail-safe replacement process. And then you can start to do more predictive analysis and replace it again right before it reaches that potential failure. So that's where you get sort of the best performance, but you got to really think through how you're going to manage the cost of that. So these are just different ways to kind of develop a maintenance strategy. All of this stuff primarily would be managed in the cartograph system, the output of this thinking. So when we have all this stuff together and we're kind of coming up through our asset plans, it's kind of where we get into the CIP part of it, is we know that we've installed these assets at some point in time. And in this particular example, we're looking at around the 60s or so. And this is like pipe. And we've got all these installations and the miles of pipe that we installed. And then we know that we're going to have to start replacing these things, and it's coming up pretty fast. And then we know that there's other assets that are being installed now, they're going to be replaced somewhere in the future. And so what we're trying to do is we're trying to forecast what the end of life is going to be and how much it's going to cost to deal with it. And then we realize that we've got this big, huge spike that's sitting out there of what would be called a potential backlog, because there's no way, no how we're going to have enough funding in that particular year to do all this work. So we've got to put in some prioritization and figure out what can we push off, what can we defer a little bit And so we kind of look at what areas of that's going to be replaced. And once we take all this information together, then we start to use this forecasting to build a financial plan. Because if you have all these assets that are deteriorating and need to be replaced or upgraded at some point in time, there's got to be money that comes in to do that. And so you got to compare what money you have going out versus the amount of money you have in your fund balance to see whether or not it balances out. And I'm sure you've been in the situation before where you've got a lot of projects and not enough money to do it all, and something ain't going to make the cut. So the question is what do we put into the program called the CIP budget versus what do we defer out? And are we making the right decisions? So that's where our prioritization process comes in. So we want to look at the impact on rates. We want to look at the funding of this. We want to see if this makes sense in terms of planning the replacement. Tie this to our financial plan. Tie this to our asset valuation process. Tie this the way we're going to acquire the assets as part of this new project. Look at it from a risk standpoint. And what we do is we do this from a business case evaluation process. We sort of balance all these things out and we say, what's the best use of the money? And this does two things. One is it helps us to analyze whether or not we make the right decision. The next is how do we present it to the people that are representing the constituents in the city so that they see that we've done everything right. So this business case evaluation process is ultimately trying to help us make the most use of capital. Anybody ever gone through this sort of thing before? Anybody ever bought a house? Do you guys, if you have somebody else you're buying the house with, do you guys ever have an argument about which house you're going to buy and how much money you're going to be spending and what part of town you're going to be living in? Those sorts of things. Does that ever happen with anybody? It's happened with me before, more than once. And really what we're doing is we're doing a business case evaluation. I can tell you what my wife wants in a house, and I can tell you what I want in a house, and they're two different things. And there is some meeting of the minds that takes place. But ultimately what we do is we come up with a process. We think about what are we trying to achieve, what do we want the house for, how much can we afford, and then we balance these things out. Well, you want this big kitchen, I don't really care about the kitchen too much, you know, what I want is a place to put my pool table, or whatever it might be. And so there's a little bit of give and take. We gotta have our man caves. And, covered garage or detached garage and all these sorts of things. And you start to put some priorities next to it. And then you go out and you look at the market and you see what's available, matches up your criteria, and then when you see the house, you say, well, forget all that stuff, I like this house. There's always these, there's a lot of emotional things that take place. And what we do in a business case evaluation is that we're trying to come up with a repeatable process by which we evaluate and make good decisions with the community's money, because it's not ours, it's the community's dollars. And what we're looking for, again, is meeting that service level requirement at the lowest possible cost that we can. So this is the business case evaluation process. So normally what we do is we start off with a problem. Likely, since they're not, it's somebody who's not sitting in the front row has a problem, and you bring it to somebody in the front row, and they're listening to you explain the problem. They go, yeah, it sounds like it's a problem, all right. The question is, are you explaining this problem effectively so that they get it in terms of it's a priority? What we do in the business case evaluation process is we do a very careful job of defining the problem. We create what's called a problem statement. And within the problem statement, we say, this is the impact it has on safety and security of the public. This is what impact it has on the levels of service to the public. It becomes a problem statement. And then if it's a big enough problem, then what we'll do is we'll grab some people from different parts. So it might be sewer and parts is going to be involved in some way, and streets is going to be involved, because if we dig up the sewer, we're going to dig up the street, and it's right in front of a park. And we get these people together, and we start saying, what are all the alternatives that we have to solve this problem? Let's lay them all out on the table, brainstorm. No bad ideas. But there are going to be some dumb ideas. But we list them out anyway, and then we take the fatal flaw eraser, and we get rid of those ones that are just playing way out there. And we're left with some valid alternatives. So what we do then is we perform a cost-benefit analysis on each alternative. So what's the, on the alternative, we go, what's the capital cost? What's the O&M cost? What's the risk cost? What's the benefit cost?
And we do that over, you know, whatever it is, the number of years of the problem that we're trying to deal with the project. And the one that comes out, we do this, called a present value analysis. The one that comes out the best cost solution becomes the best solution for the use of the money. And so after having gone through this, we have defined the problem, we've looked at all the alternatives, we've done a cost analysis, we've gone with the risk and the benefit, and we write all this stuff up into a simple technical memo or a 2 or 3 page document, and then we take it to city council and say, this is what we need to do. If we don't do it, we've got this risk. If we do it, we've got this benefit. This is how much it's going to cost. And then they look at it and say, okay, well, you've clearly defined the problem for me. I understand that. You've obviously looked at all the alternatives. You've done a net present value analysis of this, and this is the solution you came up with. 99% of the time, they will say yes. The times that they say no are usually because there's some other issue, which is usually emotional in one way or another, that you didn't think about. And it may or may not be the right decision, but it happens anyway. But in most cases, what you're doing is in presenting this business case evaluation is you're helping them to make the right decision based on the information that you provided to them. If you don't provide the information, they're like, do I trust this person? Do they really know what they're doing? Have they really looked at all the analysis? And they'll start throwing out a bunch of questions at you. If you've gone through this exercise before, you've already got all the answers, and because you've already asked all the questions, and they see it in the document. So you don't want to do this with everything. This is a laborious process. This can take weeks. It could take hours, but you only need to think about it this way, is do it when it seems to be appropriate. Do it for the big problems. Now, when you start getting to that area of cost-benefit analysis, you're gonna need data. And this is the thing where you go to the cartograph system or the GIS system, and you try to run these numbers, and it ain't there. So then it says, we need to start collecting this information in a sense. And you need to think about, does collecting this information make sense? And the answer in this case might be yes. In other case, well, this is a one-off deal, and it's going to cost more money to collect the data than it is to add any value. So you're kind of using a business case evaluation to see whether or not you need to collect the data for a business case evaluation. Does this make sense? So here's an example of using data to generate a CIP, and this is kind of the area that we're going to go into pretty quickly on Wednesday and Thursday. When we develop a CIP, capital improvement program budget, we've got a lot of ad hoc needs. These are the wish list. Oftentimes there's master plans, or maybe you guys got a facility plan or something. There's regulations that dictate, like a lot of what this new stormwater regulations are really driving a lot of what we're trying to think through now. There's some coordinated plans that might be with the county, for example, or between streets and sewers or whatever. And then there's these R&R needs that come out of your condition assessment work. All this stuff gets into a big database of just a wish list of projects. And then we've got to figure out how to prioritize that. If it's in the business strategy, it goes right in. If it's not, we do a BCE. And then there's another thing here called a program management information system. We're evaluating whether or not Cartograph is going to be that tool to do this. We're going to try it out. And Cartograph is willing to put a little bit of effort into making their system help us manage this. And then eventually, this Cartograph will be part of the asset management systems here. And so the information we get from the projects will fit down into the Cartograph tool. There goes my cursor again. And then eventually, we pull data out of that that fits back into here and continuously cycles through. So intuitively, you do this already. We're just going to try to automate it a little bit more within the Cartograph system. That's the goal. So we get down to the people and process things. Are you guys okay? Do you need to take a break? Okay. So we get...
We have it. Street is getting on it, I think, they're building on it. Jonathan has built pretty much everything in sewer and stuff.
Sewer and Cartograph helped in Port Aletta. They were coming for us.
Yeah, the storm's doing pretty good. Right now, just sat down with the city manager probably tomorrow and asking for about $35,000 to get the modules for parks, facilities, and fleet. Even though fleet runs right now on faster programs, imported into car graphs, and running one program across the board for one system. Instead of like staff is saying, we've got everybody's got music, everybody. That's where we're heading.
Yeah, and the key part about this is the IT systems is part of it, but the processes is probably the most difficult part. You know, it's 80% of it, is getting people to follow a particular process and be very straightforward. I mean, I started my career as a sewer worker, and I used to, you know, grab my sewer work orders and go out in the field, do my job, and you know, maybe I get 5 work orders done that day, whatever, and they come in at the end of the day and hand my supervisor to check them, and then I'm off heading to the bars or whatever. And at least in those days. And then I come in and I do it again the next day. And you know, you just kind of go through the motions of filling out the work orders. It wasn't until I became a supervisor and later a service center manager that I really appreciated what was going on and how the data was being used. And so what I learned as a sewer service center manager was I go out and I teach people why these work orders were being used and what the data was used for. Because I knew that when I was there, I didn't understand it all. No one ever told me what happened with the data. I just put it in the box and left. And then I started working through maintenance management systems and stuff and realized the power of the data systems. And realize a lot of people only use 10% of the systems they've got. And a lot of people collect data that they never use. So why are you doing it? And so you gotta kind of figure out how to right size it. And so the technology is one part of it. The people and how people work together is far, far more important. I've come to the belief now is that if I don't, as a consultant designing a system or whatever, if I don't take into consideration the sociology and the psychology of the user, and if I introduce a new asset management system or information, all I'm doing is getting people to failure faster. So I really got to think about how people work and how people belong to an organization to appreciate whether or not they're going to use it or not. And there's more than one type of technology. It doesn't have to be information technology. It doesn't have to be software. It could be, you know, cards. Or, you know, it could be, you know, a common folder on an Outlook calendar or something like that. There's a lot of ways to manage the stuff. So the process becomes more important, and that's what we're really trying to think through is how do we align all this stuff? And the way this diagram is set up is that the first question is, you say, what's the strategic goals that you're trying to accomplish? Now, each one of us is an individual. The question is are you all following the same strategy? Or do you think you are, and you're not? Hopefully you are. It's a small enough organization where you can actually communicate with each other. And then if we look at the strategic goals, then the second question we ask is, what are the processes that you need to do to meet the goals? And then the third thing is what do people do in the process, and how do the people work together in a process to meet a strategic goal? Where is the noise coming from? Okay, it sounds like there's little people down there talking. This is not water. So the way you kind of think through this process is that if I sit there and ask you what are your strategic goals, and then what's going to say to me is that there needs to be over here in the information system, there needs to be the function to manage the strategic goal. So you've got to have a billing system, you have to have a customer information system, you've got to have a way to track your maintenance activities, you've got to have a way to track the finance and all that sort of. So that's the functional level. When we then say, all right, so if these are strategic goals, then here's the processes you need to meet those goals, then what that's going to do, it's going to further define how these systems get designed and configured. So I need the billing system to link to GIS, and I need the maintenance management system to link to GIS so that when I see a premise and I see an account, I can see an asset and I associate that asset with that premise, with that bill, whatever it might be. You know, I think through it that way. Because ultimately, and so where the individual comes in, ultimately, people use the systems in a process to meet a goal. So they have to be in alignment. So why is it that when we go out and we buy software, we send an RFP out, we have a bunch of vendors that send proposals back, and I can tell you the way the vendors are, which I will in a minute. And then we get these vendors that come in, they send the proposals, and we analyze it by our scoring system, and we have them come in and give demos, and there's only, what, 5, maybe 10 people at the most that are evaluating the products, and then we select one. And then the vendor comes in and installs it, and they configure it based on what you told them, and based on what they ask and what you answer. And they give you a week's worth of training, and then they're gone, and then you're left over with it. And then you're saying, like, now what do we do? In most cases, it's because this stuff had not happened. You didn't define your goals. You didn't look at the processes. Didn't clearly elaborate on the way the system needs to be configured. And you didn't involve necessarily the right people to evaluate this. And they're the ones that have to use it. The ones that made it, selected it, oftentimes are not the ones that use it on a daily basis. Sometimes they do, but in a lot of cases it's not. So this is a really tricky part. And there are other ways of doing it. Now here's what the vendor does. When you send out an RFP, the vendor looks at it and says, somebody wrote that RFP for a specific vendor, I'm not gonna bid on it. And unless you have, or they've come in and tried to sell this to you already. And because they got so many RFPs to choose from, you know, they're trying to figure out where do we win, because it takes money to put a proposal together. At least $10,000 cost to put a proposal together. And so it's like a roll of the dice for them. But regardless, what we can do now, where we're at with the configuration of Cartograph is we're working on this part here. We're going to look at ways to configure Cartograph. And the way we're going to do that is we're going to spend time on Wednesday and Thursday looking at the processes. So out of the processes, we're going to get workflow and data flow and figure out how to make all this happen. I'm going to skip through that. So this is kind of the way it works in a simplistic view. I've got my stick figure here. This is a person that performs a job. Now, I could take that one performer out and replace it with a group of performers and call it a team. Or I could take that out and I could put a whole bunch of people there and call it an organization. It doesn't matter. Just think about one person performing a job. And this person has an input and an output. There's consequences with the output. There's a feedback mechanism that goes back to the performer. So what I'm getting to now is how people use information systems. So the first thing you do is you ask, what's the output? Now, if I were to come work for you, I walk in for an interview, in most cases, there are a few exceptions to this, but in most cases, I'm going to ask you, what do you expect for me to do? What's the output you expect for me to perform? I'm not going to say, what are you going to give me? I want to know what the output is. And so if you're looking at an information system or a job description or whatever, you always start with the output first, then you work backwards. So what's the report that you want out? Then you say, how do I generate the report? And then you say, what data do I need to put into it? Okay? So same with job performance. What's the performance indicator of the output? Then you ask what goes in. What's the form I need to fill out? What's the data I need to collect? Or maybe you're doing something as an output and then it becomes my input. Then I do something and it becomes your input. And then the third thing is what are the consequences if I don't hit that performance target of the output? I need to have information about that, the variance. And then I need to get that information back to me. I need to get some feedback. Is there anybody here that doesn't want to get feedback on the work they perform? And then it comes down to some of us. And then it comes down to whether or not that person has the skills and knowledge to perform that work, and do they have the capacity to do it. In other words, they might be overloaded, or they might not have enough work. So from a manager's standpoint, I want to be able to manage skills, I want to be able to manage knowledge, I want to be able to manage a person's individual capacity. I need information about that. These are the 6 spots of information we need to be able to manage performance. Output, input, consequence, feedback, skills, knowledge, and capacity to do the work. So this is what we're going to be doing on Wednesday and Thursday, is we're going to be doing what's called business process analysis. So what I could do is I could take your job, for example, and I'd say, what's task number 1, task number 2, task number 3 for you to, you know, set up a GIS system order? And that's all well and good. And we can lay those things out as a process, work order, workflow. But you work with other people. So you do something, hand it off to somebody else who does something, hands it off to somebody else who does something, and then it comes back to you again. So What we've introduced now are these things called swim lanes. So this is swim lane one, swim lane two, swim lane three. So just like in a swimming pool, you stay in your lane. You don't go outside your lane, hopefully. And you perform that work. And we talk about the interactions of what happens here. And then we introduce some information systems, like the CIS is a customer information system. CMS is computerized maintenance management system. So we start to look at, maybe we use a file system. So now we start to look at how people use data and systems within the process. And so what we start to do is we're going to start to model out the workflow and the data flow, and then we're going to be modeling out how the organization is set up, and we're going to model out how the systems interact. So we do this in sort of a virtual business model. Now, to me, I don't manage much anymore. I've got a few people that report to me in a group, but you know, let's say I'm a manager here, and then we've got this typical hierarchy. You know, he reports to she, who reports to him. He's got all these different people in here. To me, putting together an org chart is a very simple thing to do. Who reports to whom? The difficulty in an organization is, how do you manage the white space? Right, so I've never come to an organization that doesn't have silos in some form or another. And we tend to stay in our groups and stuff. We stick close together. But is Parks and Recreation learning from what Fleet does? Is Fleet learning from what Water does? Is Water learning from what Street does? Is Street learning from what Sewer does? And does Facility learn from everybody else? There's this white space in between here that's the opportunity to improve. And by looking at it from the workflow standpoint and the data flow, and then looking at the organizational and how the systems align with all of this stuff, we're really looking at ways to improve the white space in the organizational chart, where those transactions take place. So here's a process that we can look at, and what we're really kind of drilling down into is we're going to drill down into those specific problem areas and try to focus on those problem areas and look at ways at which we might be able to improve the use of the cartograph system or whatever, or maybe a recommendation comes out of this for something along those lines. And then we'll look at ways to come up with information to track performance indicators. What do we need the system? And this is just an example from the sewer side of the world about the sort of things that we would normally start to track. So all this is going to be some of a discovery that we go through as you go through the workflow diagram. So I'm just going to give you a heads up on that. So as we go through the training of people and we go through this asset management program, they call this Asset Management 101 because what we just did is kind of blurt out a whole bunch of stuff and throw a whole bunch of things at you on the screens here. And I'm going to guess that about 7% of it's stuck. It's called a recency technique. What's going to happen is we throw this stuff at you once, and then we throw it to you again, and then we throw it to you again, and we throw it to you again, and we throw it to you again, and we throw it to you the seventh time it starts to stick. And the best way to learn it is by teaching somebody else. And the reality is you don't learn it until you do it. So teaching somebody else is one way of doing it. And so what we want to try to think through in terms of the program is we want to start the training early. This is just an overview of asset management. We haven't really talked about anything that's incredible yet. We want to get the staff, you and the other people that aren't here, we want to get these to participate in these business process reviews and get you to get kind of really plugged into the technology part. Because what's really going to happen is that we're going to start to look for ways to set up teams. First part's going to be on the CIP prioritization stuff. We're going to get these teams together and start thinking about ways to innovate. Because let me suggest this to you. You do not want the consultant to do this for you. Because there's a finite contract period here. And what we're really trying to do is facilitate a starting point. You can build some momentum so that you guys can take over on this. Because you're smarter about your system than we are. All we're going to do is kind of introduce you to some concepts, kickstart you a little bit, and then really kind of build what we're going to call a pilot. So the CIP piece through Cartograph, if it works the way we think it's going to work, it's going to need to get some momentum behind it. So it's going to be a pilot, and then once we learn how this thing works and we start to roll that out, into a final system. And then, as you were talking about before, with you know buying the extra modules, it's we start to get some energy behind it. The other thing that I strongly suggest is that you establish a user group. So you guys have been working with Cartograph a lot longer than you guys have. So if you get a user's group together, you can start to learn what they've already learned. So you don't make the same mistakes that they did. And then you'll come up with some cool, innovative ideas that you can then say, hey, here's what we found out. And then everybody shares. And then you have a lot of information, a lot of questions that you take to the vendor, and you let them help you solve those problems because you're paying for it. Right? And so then you just keep this going. You know, monthly meetings, quarterly meetings, start off with monthly, move to quarterly, maybe then every 6 months after that. But just get these things together. Have a formal place where you all sit together, having a formal agenda, go through what works, what doesn't work, what's the forms we use, what's the data, what's the reports we've got, what works, what doesn't work. Come up with a bug list and have one person that interfaces with the vendor that comes back, not the IT person, one person that interfaces with the vendor and tells them what the problems are. And the reason why I say not the IT person is that the IT person already thinks they know the answer to this from a technology standpoint. They aren't using the system as you guys would.
Yeah, I may be jumping way ahead of the program here, but I'm already exposed to a system that you described very well earlier where those things weren't thought out, and that's become our main database here. And so to make improvements, because lots of great ideas have come up in the 3 years that we've had the system, there's no way to make those improvements.
Why not?
I can't answer that because I wasn't involved in it, but the answer that I get quite often is, well, unfortunately, we can't input that into the database. So I can't. My question to you would be, is this something, whatever we're doing here, is it going to be able to, you know, grow with the city, mold change as needs change, as performances die out and new ones develop? Is this something that's going to be able to move forward with it?
Well, the answer to the question is I have no idea what you're talking about.
You and my wife are
so what system are you talking about?
Here in the city, in this building, we have a system called Eden, and it's not a very good system.
Okay. Yeah.
And the reason it's not a very good system, you outlined right there, the wrong people were involved in the input. There's no way to upgrade it, and I just didn't want to get into names.
Yeah, okay. I think in that scenario, what you would do is clearly define what the problem is. And then you find out, huh?
I said that's pretty easy.
Okay, so you put right up a paragraph, and then you get with Rob as an example. And you start with Rob and say, this is what I see as the problem. And then you guys say, let's get a group of people here, and let's start to figure out what this problem really is. And you look at the problem, who's the best people to come in and kind of analyze the problem. You might get more information about it. Anytime someone comes back and says, I can't get the database to do that, I don't believe that. I mean, a database is a database.
Right.
You know, the question is how much is it going to cost to solve the problem, and what's the benefit of many people? And so you have to look at all the alternatives. One is we can do nothing, continue to live with it, we can come up with a workaround. Another is we spend some money to get it reconfigured or customized differently. Third is we buy another product that sits on top of it, that works with it and does the function that we want it to. And of course, if we trash the whole thing and buy another one. Those are examples of alternatives. And then what you do is you run a cost-benefit analysis of each one of those alternatives and say, what's the best use of the community's money? If we do nothing, this is how much it's going to cost us. This is how much it's going to cost us over time. If we do a reconfiguration of this or customization, it's going to cost us $50,000 and we're going to get a payback in 18 months. If we buy another product, it's going to cost us $110,000, it's going to get a payback in 3.5 years. If we buy a whole new product, it's going to cost us $4 million, it's going to get a payback in 10 years. Whatever that is. Then as a group, you've got an ability to make a decision. But you really, instead of just like holding on to the problem and feeling bad about it, you've got to get the group together and decide what's the best use of the community's money and what's the best use of us supplying service with this. That's kind of the way I would do it.
That's suspicious of the business case.
It is a business case evaluation.
But there's a lot of those things.
And you're not alone. Every organization, including mine, has those things.
I'm sure. And I didn't mean to make it sound like it was unique, but you know, I mean, you, when you see this kind of for lack of a better term, failure, you at some point you want to say, wait a minute, we're doing something wrong here. What is it we're doing wrong? That's what you're describing.
What I'm describing is to take the words failure and turn them into opportunity for improvement. And what we want to try to do as a result of this project is to educate people on how to do that. Because you guys know more about the problems of the organization than anybody. And so you guys are the most likely people to solve the problem. The question is do I have the power to do it? There's only a certain amount. I don't know the frustrations that we had in the front row go to, but I can kind of see it in their face sometimes. But I know that there are limitations. There are constraints on what we can do as a public utility organization, public work. So what we got to do is figure out how much influence do we have, how far can we go with it, and do the best we can within our means. Because there's some things we'll just plain have to live with. And some things you just wait till the product dies or wait till somebody retires or whatever. And that might be part of the plan, is just a weight amount sort of thing.
But yeah, that's the sort of thing to think through. And then the last part is the asset knowledge piece, and so we're okay on time. So the real question is that we are constantly working with data, constantly working with the information system, which is really a lot of value is in that information. It costs a lot of money to collect data, and it costs some money to store it. It costs a lot of money to analyze it. And what we do with information systems is that we can analyze it to improve reliability. We can do this to manage and measure performance. We can do this to manage risk, for example. We can do this to forecast budgets on capital or the O&M side. And there's a lot of data that's always, you know, that's not connected. We want to sort of connect those asset information systems and things. There's a lot of ways to accomplish this. The key thing to do up front is to establish a hierarchy of the way the data is set up, called an asset hierarchy. So at the top level is the enterprise. Everything that we own. And then we break it down into sections, if you want to call it that. Then there's the facility or the process basin. And then we come down to the functional system, and then we come down to the components of that. So it might be the entire city, it might be the wastewater department, it might be the wastewater treatment plant, it might be the pump station, it might be the pump and the motor. It might be the entire system, it might be the wastewater system, it might be the such and such basin, it might be the sub basin, it might be the manhole, it might be the manhole lid. Those sort of things. The reason why we want to have hierarchy is that when we have a hierarchy in the GIS, we have a hierarchy in the maintenance management system, we have a hierarchy in the SCADA system, we have a hierarchy in the laboratory information system, we have a hierarchy in the fixed asset register. We want them all to be in the same discussion, in the same family, and we want to have the numbers the same. Now, the facility ID may be different than an asset ID, but we have a direct relationship between those two. What a lot of potential is to integrate this stuff into one big database, a data mart, or through some type of system integration approach. This is King County, actually. So King County uses a business intelligence solution, and all the data from all these different systems gets copied into one big thing called a data mart or data warehouse. And they use a web browser to be able to analyze that data. So they can look at the chemical costs or electrical costs of a facility out of the financial system. They can look at the condition monitoring data out of a video or a report that an outside vendor does. They can get the maintenance records out of the maintenance management system. They can get the pump runtime out of the SCADA system, and only go one place to get all that data. So what happens is that every night, those little individual databases copy data into one big database called a data mart. There's a software that sits over the top of it that interrogates it, and then the viewer sits on a web browser and analyzes that data. The software costs $25,000. And it took a consultant about $35,000 to implement this stuff, so it costs $60,000. Cheap, right? However, since I was the consultant that did that, it was almost about $650,000 to get all the data and the processes set up. the first thing that happened when we built all this integration system, we found out that they didn't have all the data they needed. They didn't have condition data. They didn't have work orders set up right to collect failure codes. And the fixed asset register was by project, not by asset. So if there was a pump station, for example, the pump station was depreciated, not the pump and the motor and the building at separate schedules. So all that stuff had to be fixed. So, you know, it took about 18 months to, you know, kind of rearrange all this stuff. But now they're in a different realm. They've got reliability-centered maintenance approach. They've got asset engineers working at the plant. They've got people who do thermography, and they've got a lubrication expert who goes around making sure that everything's maintained properly. I mean, they've completely changed their world, and they've reduced their staff over time through natural attrition by around 17%, which reduced their O&M budget. And they built a brand new plant without adding any more staff. So the efficiencies came out of it, but it just took a while. The bigger problem was the cultural change that took place, because nobody wanted to do this stuff. Nobody wanted to collect extra information. They weren't used to doing that, and it was a pain for a lot of people. They've forgotten about it now, but it was a pain in 2006. So there's different ways to collect and review data. If you've ever been on the internet, you've seen pictures of stuff, little speed dials. You look at stuff on a map is always fun. Pareto charts and these sort of things. But then the other thing that's happening is that we want better ways to access the data. So Cartograph has an iPad tool. Do you guys use that?
It's not rolled out. Okay.
And a lot of SCADA systems now you can get on an Android device. And Smart Glance, I think they call it. And anyway, everybody's going in that sort of direction of how do you get to the data. And then, of course, when you're integrating all these different things, you know, you can do a lot more forecasting and planning. So in our aspect, we're talking about the capital improvement program and prioritization. So we've got asset management data, you know, in GIS and CMMS in particular. And so the question is I'm going to run through a little scenario about how all this stuff can work in terms of generating a CIP. And then what your specific roles are. So it works like this. We start off with the GIS system into an asset inventory, and then we do a risk assessment. So what comes out of the risk assessment are two things. On one side, we've got the high-risk assets, those critical ones. Then on the other side, we've got the low-risk assets, the ones not so critical. So from the high-risk assets then, what we're gonna do is start look at the failure modes. Why do things fail? And as we analyze the different failure modes, then we can generate an O&M strategy. How do we reduce and mitigate that side? But then from both the low risk and the high risk stuff, then we come down and do condition assessment, measure the performance of the assets. What comes out of this then becomes this update of the information inventory. We learn from the condition assessment. And then the other thing comes out of there are actions. These actions become our R&R projects, rehabilitation replacement projects. Now we take that. We run these things through some sort of a prioritization process, and what comes out of the prioritization process then is our CIP. So critical points here are, the first thing is that we need to use a risk assessment early on in the process to see whether or not we're going in the right direction with our resources. We don't just want to analyze everything. We want to get the high risk stuff out of the way first. Second thing is that not everything that we're going to do is going to be in the CIP. There might be ways to do this through an O&M budget, right? So we don't have to just build things. We can come up with strategies to not build things. And the third, probably the most important, is involving and integrating the staff into the condition assessment process. Because I'm thinking that probably around 3/4 of you are touching assets on a regular basis. And so every time you touch an asset, you're getting some information through a sensory condition assessment, you know, smelling, seeing, maybe you're tasting, I don't know. You're definitely visualizing and hearing things. And what you're doing is you're getting condition data. And are we taking that information and storing it or communicating it in some way to the people who are making decisions on the engineering design side or the capital project side? So we need to really think about the condition assessment, performance assessment process. that data is critical for us doing the analysis of the CIP and the prioritization process. So like in that example I gave with King County, they weren't doing that. They didn't have condition data. So it's pretty impossible to make decisions if you don't have information about the problem. And then we look at it in a simplistic viewpoint. When we start to look at priorities, we want to look at what are the factors that we're trying to plan against, and then we want to get both, you know, operations and maintenance and engineering and the asset management group as a whole to think through this and give it a number of some sort in terms of priority. And hopefully we're doing that with some dollars behind that and being able to justify it. So the components of asset management on the to be called the successful thing is you've established this hierarchy. Like we talked about before, you know, the parent-child type of relationship. You've got a mechanism by which the databases are updated, so you store all that information. And you've got this rating system of criticality or risk. You've got the inspections that take place on the sensory inspections, condition assessment part. And then we've got the ability to kind of forecast when this deterioration is going to take place. And then we can update these maintenance and plans and rehab plans and whatnot. Which then becomes part of our O&M strategy. So we're continuously updating information systems, and we're using these information systems in our business case evaluation to support the decision making. And because we write all this stuff up, we've got justification to go get more money or additional funding necessary to do the program. How many people will buy that? So it's intuitively you're doing this already, right? It's just kind of putting it into more of a form and step-by-step process, a methodology, if you will, that makes it easier so we're not, you know, spending less time doing reactive work and doing more on the proactive side. That's the real objective here. So summarizing this all is we want to kind of align all this stuff. We want the information systems to be used effectively by people working together in a common process, and the processes to be in alignment with the strategic goals. So that means clearly define the goals up front, which we started to do months now. Next is to identify those key indicators of how we manage performance, and that's where we get down into the processes at the enterprise-wide level, which we're going to do on Wednesday and Thursday. Then we start looking at how people use this across the processes and how they use information systems, and we try to build a culture where people are sharing that information, or what we call a knowledge-sharing culture. I think that's it. That is it. Any questions?
let me end with just that. I don't know about knowing you before. I'm new to HDR, but I managed the utility analysis of water and wastewater utilities. And the same approach, this Australian New Zealand approach, I remember the first time I was sitting in your seats and heard this stuff probably 10, 15 years ago now. And I just go, I'm drinking. A lot of it starts making sense. It clicks a little bit, but then you're going, well, you know, he's right, though. We're already doing this. You know, maybe I can tweak our program a little bit. Do we really have to change it? Those are common questions. Like that. It's good to have that because one shows you're engaged. The second thing is that remember the idea that Scott was talking about, that you're taking this peel the onion kind of approach to this thing, in that you're slowly moving forward. You don't have to have a huge, giant asset management plan to start with. It's okay if you're on the water side and haven't been doing as much as the sewer side yet. Now but you need to think about this communication moveover. In Albuquerque, when we were able to pull together this overall asset management plan, perhaps the biggest success that I had as a manager out of it was it got me communicating directly with the guys that were doing the asset work, because I knew I was listening to them. And probably even better, and this is even more symbolic here, is I see all of these little catch basins from all the BS that goes on in this room here. And beforehand, we used to, you know, get on the council agenda. We would get there at 9 or 10 o'clock at night. They were tired. They didn't want to hear it. They didn't care. You know, if your budget was in 2% or what, fine, we'll approve. We were able to come back and justify moving funding for capital and O&M, capital, you know, and
mark contributions between enterprise and non-enterprise funds, so that pretty soon we were developing systems that could be used citywide, and we were leading that, and the whole IT department kind of stepped back and said, let these guys go, they're doing the right thing. So I just wanted to say, don't feel bad about it, but I will also say this is, there's a lot of new concepts here, and when you're sitting down with Scott over these next couple of days, it's really important that you think you contribute, because right now, you are real valuable assets from the standpoint of the information and knowledge that you have, that no one else really has.
Good question. You had that the model of the worker with the input and the output. Your first question should be the output. Basically, like I said, my question would be is, what is your guys' goal that you're going to provide us when you leave? What will we sit with? Just the knowledge of how to get started, or will we have basically the foundation there that we can start now adding inventory and structure to it?
It's kind of like coaching while you're like you're doing this marathon, where you like run alongside just saying, put your knees and your arms on. The first part about it is to kind of show you how to do it. Second step is we walk through it step by step and tell you this is what I'm doing. The third is for you to do it, for us to listen to you. You say this is how I'm doing it. So you do it, those three approaches, and you sort of win at it. So we're really focused on the CIP prioritization process. When we get into the business processes, what we're trying to do is we're trying to discover what the process is, how do we do it, how do we improve it. We're looking at two things, the workflow and the data flow. The workflow is going to be you guys interacting and saying, well, why do you do it that way? We do it this way. And so we come to what's called an as-is scenario, the way you do it right now, and then we move to a should-be scenario. That's what we want to be doing. All we're doing is facilitating a discussion. You guys are doing the talking. What we come out of at the end of these sessions is two things. We come out with a diagram of the workflow and data flow. We come with a Word document that describes all the things we talked about. But what's really more important is that the people that are participating in the workshop have this, now I see the big picture. Now I see what my role is in the process. And then innovative ideas should start from that. So that's the starting point that we can't finish. So that part of it, we get started. Now, getting into the real meat of the question is, what's the end product of us? Our goal is to build a tool within Cartograph to prioritize projects that go into the CIP. And I've worked with Cartograph a little bit, not a lot, but they have a product right now in their transportation module, which is a prioritization tool for managing pavement. They're coming out with a new product, I think it's this month, the new release. And what they're doing is they're taking that prioritization module and they're laying that across all the other tools through a single module. And what our thought is that we can develop this prioritization process within that new module. Now, we don't know what it looks like. We don't know if it's going to work, but that's the goal. We're going to be developing an Excel spreadsheet to do the prioritization process in a spreadsheet. So if this Cartograph thing doesn't work or it's going to take a while, at least we've got a spreadsheet and we're working on the process. Maybe the Excel spreadsheet is all we need. Maybe the Excel spreadsheet is just a band-aid temporary fix or whatever. But if Cartograph doesn't work, we're going to have enough understanding about the process to be able to find another tool that will match up with the requirements. Or we just use the Excel spreadsheet, or better yet, we get the Cartograph system. Our hope is that by going through this, you embark on asset management concepts, starting with probably the most important thing, managing capital, managing the community's money. And then you guys will start thinking about this and saying, what's the next logical step? And you'll go through this business process analysis thing, we'll do a business case evaluation. We hope to teach you how to do that. And then someone will have the great idea that, hey, we need to do a business case evaluation when we're looking at this X project. And then you guys will do that. And then as you do it and you continue to do it, you'll learn from how to do that. And then we'll kind of get you rolling on that. That was a long answer to your question. Did I answer your question?
I think so. I was just wondering if you're going to set up the structure and, you know, I guess have Cartograph all set in place.
We're going to have Cartograph do that.
Okay.
really part of the group, because they can manage their system better than we could. And you don't want, trust me on this, you don't want the consultant to be your software support tool. We're too expensive for the salesperson. Yeah. Any other questions?
Well, just to follow up with John, I think we've done a pretty good job of constructing our asset inventories. But, you know, our learning curves have been very steep. We're not database managers. We're trying right now to kind of figure our way through to do reports, begin to use work orders, those kinds of things. And I was kind of hoping that the outcomes of this was going to be maybe some insight into that. And I haven't gotten a call.
Okay. Yeah, that's a good question. Reports are a big touchy issue. What I normally do with reporting side, and we're going to be working on the CIP prioritization process, so we'll be working on those reports. But if it's something like a reliability report or an overtime report or something else you might get out of heart, we're not going there on this project.
I'm really serious. I'm talking just about fundamentals, about how using Cartograph to install our budgets so that I can work.
Right.
All those kinds of things are still pretty much undone and a little cryptic.
Yeah.
I have all of the things that I have to do, and it's just, like I said, it's kind of looking at it.
Okay. When we talk about the business processes, one of the things we're going to be doing is talking about the outputs. And I'm going to be asking during the workshops for you to email me examples of reports that you have. And if you don't, then we're going to go down this path. We're going to start with an 8.5 by 11 piece of paper and say, draw out what you want the report to look like. You know, what do you want? You know, do you want it into you know, a table like this? Or do you want a pie chart? What do you want to be here? What do you want to be at the headings? And as a software designer, this is what I used to do. Because I actually built a maintenance management system in 1993 using a tool called FoxPro. What you do then is you lay out on a piece of paper what you want the report to look like. And you lay out what's called data elements. Like if I'm measuring a depth of a manhole, do I want it in feet and inches or do I want it in tenths of feet? You have to define that. So I have manhole depth in feet or manhole diameter in inches, whatever it might be. And I lay this thing out and then I give it to the software designer. The software designer can come in there and create this report within their tool. Now there are reporting tools that you could install on top of a database or in some cases, and I don't know what Cartograph uses for their reporting tool, there will be some limitation on what they can and cannot do within their database, so we have to analyze that. But the more important thing is what kind of reports do you need? And you probably have an idea. I would like to have, you know, maybe it's a budget report. I want to have my budget laid out by month by the different cost categories I've got. But then I also want to have the actuals. And I also want to be able to use the historical information to forecast what my cost is going to be over the next 7 weeks or something like that. So it might be a budget to actual report that you get on the third Friday of every month that has a little tool in there that helps you forecast what your chemical cost is or electrical cost or whatever. And so what we would do is sit down in the process talk about the outputs and say, do you have this or do you not? If you don't, then we might formulate a group to go off and run away and create these reports. And then the group comes back with those reports. We analyze this to see whether or not it makes sense. And then we say, how much will it cost to get this report done? And if Cartograph can do that for, say, $5,000, then we'll let them do it. It's going to cost $25,000, and we have to look at another alternative for doing that. So on this project, we're going to be talking about reports that will come out to support us on the CIP process. Hopefully, while we go through that, we'll talk about how does one go about creating reports and what do we want the report to look like. So that if you got something else you need to do, you can kind of take that approach. Did I answer the question or am I in a different area?
Well, yeah, kind of peripherally. What I'm currently doing is I'm downloading the database and into Excel and
right.
My own reports.
Right. And do you like doing that?
No.
Okay. So you would rather have a standard report?
I mean, I can customize it, I can make it, you know. But we have a product that would be nice to be able to just, you know,
right.
use Cartograph and see.
So that would be an example of me saying, why don't you send me a screenshot of what your Excel spreadsheet looks like? And it's going to look something like I can fit on 8.5 by 11 piece of paper. And then I talk to the Cartograph people, or somebody talks to Cartograph people and says, can you develop this report? I'm assuming that if you're going into Cartograph, you're exporting that to Excel. Are you manually putting in any other information, or is all the information you have in Excel spreadsheet coming out of the Cartograph database?
It's all out of Cartograph.
Then in the cases of that database, there's probably 99% of the time they're going to be able to generate that report.
I've been playing with Access and making reports in Access. I'm pretty comfortable with Excel. But again, you know, it's just like the vagaries of their reporting is, you know, but it's some of the mechanics, and, you know, how to set up your annual budgets. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the other thing that, like in the case of some of the other clients I've worked with, what happens is that, anybody know what Cartograph sits on? Is it a SQL database or SQL Server? So there's a SQL database, and there's the Cartograph application that sits on top of here, and it writes down to a data location, and it brings the data back up, and then you've got the user interface that's on here, i.e. our computer. And so you're typing in stuff into fields, and then it goes to this application that writes to the database and brings data back, and then pops it up on your screen. So when you export it to Excel, what you're doing is you're going through the application. What it's doing is taking data out of the SQL database and putting it over to Excel. The other thing you can do is you can take data out of the SQL database without going through Cartograph by location, and bringing that also into an Excel spreadsheet. All right, so what you can do is, if Cartograph isn't going to allow us to change this database over here because it's going to cost too much money and cause them too many headaches, then what we can do is we can use another tool called a business intelligence tool that sits on top of a database. We take the data that we want out of this SQL database and copy it over into another database, like Access in a way, but this will be another SQL database. Then we use this business intelligence tool to have our own little reporting engine. And the advantage is that we can take information out of Cartograph, we can also take information out of the financial system, we can take information out of the SCADA system and copy all that into one tool. This is that $25,000 tool that reports up through here. And basically, you still have to input data into Cartograph, but we're just copying it over every hour or every night, whatever, into this other tool called Business Intelligence Solution. That's what I would call a workaround. The only advantage to doing the BI solution is that you want some data from Cartograph and some data from the financial system and some data from the SCADA system. Like, maybe work history is in here, electric cost is in here, but sub-power is coming out of the SCADA system. And instead of sneaking around, pulling that information, copying the database, you have it dumped into this data mart every night. And then you run through that. The other thing you can do is you can run reports off the SQL database. Crystal reports, for example, you know, business objects, things like that. And there's other tools, like there's a tool called ClickView. Very inexpensive software that you can lay on top of a database to run reports and do things called cubes. Analysis. That's three alternatives. The fourth alternative is do what you're doing now and automate the Excel spreadsheet to automatically pull and run through a series of macros.
I've done that.
Yeah. So there's a lot of different scenarios, and what we've got to do is kind of think through. We've got to always start with the output first, right? So the output in your particular case is the report, and then we say, in order to generate this report, what are the calculations that need to take place? And then what's the data input that's necessary to do that? And so we say, is the data going in? If the data's not going in, you're not gonna be able to generate this report. Does the system have the ability to calculate and do the analysis? If the system does not have to do that, can it be configured to do that? So form, process,
how the tool gets configured, but we always have to start with what the output is first, the report. And it sounds like you already know what you want. But the going rate for a report is $5,000 per report. It's kind of a budget number. Sometimes it's more than that.
I was told they could do it for you at no cost. Go through their mods program.
Well, you should always leverage your relationship with the vendor and get them to do it for you as part of your service and agency.
Well, you could try to do a workaround.
Yeah, that's why you want
to start looking at charging you money now.
That's the reason why you don't want to do too much of the level of customization.
Well, you know, and that's kind of the struggle I'm having. It's like, it's a relational database, but the way that Paragraph has set this thing up, it won't go find a field if it doesn't have a certain, it's hard to describe.
Generate a report from two different asset types on a one report, basically, unless you use some kind of a
firewalls between some of their tables. Why? I don't know why.
But what I understand is that their new version is going into a multi-dimensional database instead of a tabular database. It's a complete architectural change.
That web OMS?
Yeah.
Yeah. And from what I understand, they're still about a year out before they're all modules.
What a lot of software companies, the way they evolve is they start off with a particular niche, and then they say, okay, we can make more money by selling to the petroleum industry, and then they create a petroleum module, and like they've got one for transportation, which is a separate module, you know, and then so now you got three different modules, and then maybe a fourth and a fifth, and then they were designed by different people, even though the same company, designed by different design engineers with a different logic, different code, whatever. Maybe they use the same architecture, but not the same framework. And then they sell these as modules, and maybe you've got a base tool or whatever, but they don't necessarily cross over. And in the case of what you're describing, that may be what it is. I don't know enough about it.
Yeah, you know, in general, I'm pretty satisfied with the product.
They're a good company to work with, too, I find.
Yeah. And so I don't misunderstand how they're going
to cross
out. But, I mean, I'm not an expert. Down these dead ends sometime, and I can't figure out how to get to the next level.
So yeah,
it's been very good, and that's why we could use some.
Yeah, well, we probably ought to just take that as an example and just kind of do some reverse engineering, problem solving on it, see where it can build.
One thing Cartograph has said is that probably the only thing they're not proud of is the reporting tool. It's a third party tool, and that's not Prisma, I believe, but
SQR.
It's like the weakest part of the whole.
Yeah. I mean, recognize that most software that's out there is not entirely built by the vendor. You know, they buy little subroutines and stuff in their place, or they download them. You know, there's a little engine that they get, subroutine somebody else developed, and they piece them together, like building a house. Any other questions? So, I'm going to use this sort of a scale. Like we talked about a lot of asset management stuff, and I want to know where your fuel tank is in terms of how much of this stuff you retain. I had no idea what he talked about. I'm okay. I'm like, oh, I got everything right here. He's right there. Anybody else? Where are you guys at? I want you about right here. Okay, good. See, now the thing is that you remembered 3%, you remembered 3%, you remembered 3%. So if we go around here, we've got 100% of everything. So if you guys work together, then you're up here. Well, thanks everybody for coming. Hopefully, if you know somebody who needs to be here, we'll actually talk to your supervisor, whatever. We want as many people understanding what's going on. Like Scott said, there's a ton of information here today. We did the same thing. We started out, this is just CIP. Prioritization, that's what we wanted. When we got into it, we found out we needed to know more about asset management than we ever thought we would need to know. So we've been dealing with that part. But this all started out exactly what Scott's saying. We went to council in 2007 with the Neighborhood Street Program for
first thing council said was, who prioritizes this? And I said, well, we sat down with all the supervisors, the people that know. We came up with a list. I go, we don't like that list. Because we didn't have a methodology spelled out in a program type of deal. And that's what we're gonna get here, is a methodology that we can stand and go, here's the process.
I know what the
you want to change it, that's fine.
That's what the noise
this
was.
This is the outcome we got from that process. So hopefully we'll get there when this is all done across the board, everywhere. Compare every project, compare a police car to a play structure, whatever, and they can decide which one's more important than which one they want. So thanks again.
Okay. So on Wednesday, I don't have that list here. What do I do with it? So I went through a little bit on this business process stuff. How many people plan on being here on Wednesday? Okay, a lot. What's that? Which one's first? Do you know? Okay. All right. Well, we're going to be going through the business process, so I'll teach you as we go.